think if Graham Thorpe starts whacking one or two around off the occasional off spin of Mark Waugh, I think what Mark Taylor will do, he'll get the quicks on and hope to go off for bad light and start again tomorrow. You see, good shot.
Well, that was the final score after that boundary, 52-3, and what a struggle it was. Butcher out for 13, Atherton for 8, Stewart for 3, and Hussain and Thorpe hung on. Hussain's been there for ages for 2, but he's still there. But the biggest problem for the Australians is will Warne be fit for the third day coming up? You have the situation where he obviously has a muscle problem, and in the end, Mark Taylor decided to come off the field just by having Glenn McGrath stand there and indicate that he might come on to bowl. The light was bad enough for the umpires to offer it to the batsman. McGrath, 7 overs, 2 maidens, none for 15. Kasperwitz, I thought, bowled pretty well. 6 overs, 3 maidens, 2 for 8. Not just the figures, but he had the ball moving away in the air from the right-handers. That's the way it looks after 2 days of play. England, 14 runs ahead, and it really is a very, very good contest on a pitch which is allowing all sorts of things to happen out there in the centre.
The greatest dismissals in Test cricket. Can you spot Shane Warne's flipper? And who exactly is Pudd? Henry Blofeld joins me now. Well, my dear, I think we'll be joined by Jack Russell, Colin Cowdery and the odd Australian. Do join us.
It's just not cricket. Bank Holiday Monday, 10:45, BBC Two.
All human life is here. And as I say, the odd Australian, my dear old thing.
Well, apologies that we're unable to bring you the cricket highlights at the moment, but I can tell you the shape of Sunday night here on BBC Two, starting with the social importance of a housing estate in Roehampton. Building sites is at 6:35, reflecting on more 20th century architecture. There's a monster on the loose at 6:45. Tuvok got the job of it for Sunday night on BBC Two. Cricket now on BBC Two and highlights of today's action from the Oval with Richie Benno.
On the same day, the Australian Cricket Board initiated a formal request for the urn containing the ashes to accompany Mark Taylor's men on their return to Australia. There were contrasting fortunes for the opposing spin bowlers. Pleasure? It's all Phil Tufnell's as he spun his way to a well-deserved 7-wicket haul. The pain? That was all Shane Warne's as he pulled a groin muscle during a 7-over spell during which he turned the ball extravagantly but took no wickets. Mark Taylor certainly needs Warne to be fit today as England resume their second innings, already 3 wickets down and desperate for a total big enough to give their bowlers something at which they'll be able to bowl when the Australians bat again. Well, welcome to the third day's play in the highlights, and we have had 2 fascinating days so far. It's been terrific stuff, and today the England middle order, which hasn't so far distinguished itself completely in the series, will need to bat very well indeed if they're to put the Australians under pressure. Now, this is the way it all begins today. 52 on the board and 3 wickets down, England in their second innings. Thorpe, I thought, played magnificently yesterday afternoon. It's only 22 runs, but it was just what was needed to get the Australians off balance towards the end. Butcher out for 13, Atherton for 8, and Stewart for 3. A delightful exhibition from Michael Kasperwitz, who isn't the luckiest bowler in the world. I've seen him bowl very well on a number of occasions without any good fortune at all. Here, he's been rewarded by 2 wickets for 8 from 6 overs and 3 maidens. And Shane Warne struggling with that leg injury. It's a torn muscle in the thigh. 7 overs, 5 maidens and no wicket for 9. So the situation, now England are 12 runs ahead. There is a change in the scoreboard there. The Australians, 220 all out. 2 extra runs added to Blewett for something that was given as a 4 and should have been a 6. So it's England 180 and 52 for 3, and the Australians 220 all out, England 12 runs ahead. Well, there's no doubt yesterday there was some extraordinary turn on what I think is a very strange oval pitch. Phil Tufnell spun the ball alarmingly for the Australians. Shane Warne got that extravagant turn we were talking about. And here's Geoffrey Boycott now to give us his ideas on what the pitch might do today.
Yesterday, Shane Warne bowled an absolute beauty to Nasser Hussain. It pitched, it turned so much, it beat the bat, the stumps, the wicketkeeper, slip and went for byes. And that was the problem. He didn't get any wickets yesterday, but he was turning it out of the rough, off the pitch, and actually he was turning it too much, but still creating such a lot of pressure. And I think that's what he's going to do today. He's going to be a major factor. He's got all this rough to bowl into here, these footmarks. He's using those. He's actually turning it off the pitch because it's very, very dry. But actually, it's really turning too much. They're too good at the balls for anybody to get a nick, so he'll either get a bucket full of wickets today or he'll not get any and just create pressure. Now then, the seamers are getting wickets, and I just want to show you the other end very quickly. We've all been surprised by this oval pitch. I said it was going to turn 2 or 3 days, but it's turned much quicker than we expected. And see here, this is unusual. You can see the top going when the seamers pitch the ball, and it's going through sometimes low, sometimes a little bit high. There's another one here, and this is creating the problems for the batsmen against the seamers. So what you've got is difficulties at both ends, and it's not going to be easy for England this morning.
No, it's certainly not going to be easy out there. Difficulties for the batsman and difficulties for Shane Warne as well. He's fit enough to take the field this morning, but his thigh is very heavily strapped. We're going to join him. He's bowling the first over of the day. This is the third ball, and Warner's bowling it in quite gingerly fashion. Nasser Hussain is taking strike. No runs have been added to the overnight total.
That's edged away. That's out. That's out. Well, just the start that England wished to avoid. And Shane Warne has done exactly what he's paid to do. He's been assisted by Nasser Hussain. It was a poor shot. As he laid back to cut, it was the top edge, which spooned up to Matthew Elliott at backward point. Elliott, it seemed, took himself, he took just a couple of steps to assess the flight of the ball in the air. Well, it's an early start of the day for Mark Ramprakash. Just 4 runs in the first innings. An immense amount of pressure on him now. Fine shot. Well, a very emphatic way in which to get off the mark. That's beautifully played. Long stride with the front foot. A very good piece of work down there as well. Sean Young. That's 4 runs, nicely played. Australia, unsurprisingly, opting to have the men in catching positions this morning, first thing. No third man. And Graham Thorpe able to get right on top of that one. That's a beautiful hit. In front of square, 4 runs all the way.
Well, he's got a good approach to Warne so far in this innings, Ramprakash. He's looking for every opportunity to score against the leg spinner.
Greg Blewett at short leg again was the man in the firing line. It was a big inside edge, and well, it would have been extraordinary had he been able to grasp the ball properly. Yes! That's bounced extraordinarily, I think. Very awkward delivery. Remember, Mark Ramprakash was caught at short leg in the first innings. This one has bounced and turned. That's tennis ball stuff. Shane Warne now trying round the wicket as a ploy to Graham Thorpe. He struggled to get the line right over the wicket to the left-hander. Now that's beautifully played. Tossed it up. He got the length up there, but was a genuine half volley. Three runs to Graham Thorpe.
In the air and stopped. Very well bowled, but the bat perhaps just sloping downwards kept the ball down. Oh, catch it, they said. It landed probably on Greg Blewett's foot. Again. Well, we've seen close fielders whacked on the ankle and foot this time. And, oh, on the knee. And that's why it went up in the air. Good shot. Nice judge of length and well back and waiting. Four runs, big cheer. What a good contest out there. Good shot. Very well played by Thorpe. Patiently patting away the good balls and waiting for the bad one. For every run, and a heavier applause, of course, for the 100 coming up. And the England lead now 60. Scampering the first and sprinting the second. Direct hit and an appeal, but I think Ram Prakash is home. And that is the 50 partnership.
Chance to catch it, but it was perfectly timed and brilliantly placed because Matthew Elliott is there for the lofted stroke on the sweep. And there's a man out on the boundary as well, and it's gone right between the two of them. Looks like more buys. Don't think he got an inside edge onto that. Just need to wait for umpire Willie. Well, he's given it as a nick. Half century for Graham Thorpe, tremendous effort. And they all count. Lovely square drive, plays that well. Only one slip in a gully there for Sean Young.
Taylor has quite clearly observed that this partnership is going well for England, and obviously with a mind to the runs that he might have to chase in the final innings, has restricted Sean Young to just the slip in the gully.
Well bowled. Well, Thorpe has been very disciplined this morning. One of the rare times he's been drawn into a shot like this.
Yep, another four again. It's going England's way very nicely. Lead of 91, that will be.
Beautifully taken by Mark Taylor. That ball seemed to fly very quickly just to the left of the Australian captain at first slip. And it's the end of a very worthy innings. Mark Taylor had to be very sharp there. But Graham Thorpe just drawn into playing this. It was very similar to the ball earlier in the over, which he played at and missed. Hello. 131 now for five. No ball called. And overthrows. Well, a bonus here for England. Matthew Elliott was diving after it. He's had to pick himself up and chase another 50, 60 yards to retrieve it.
That's out. Ooh, that's out. It's got to be out. I thought for a moment he wasn't going to give it, but he was absolutely plumb. No doubt at all. Very sad for Adam Holyoake, but I don't think there's any doubt about that. He just got himself all mixed up on the back foot. It hit him before he could get the bat down. He's absolutely plumb.
Adam Holyoake gone for four. England's now six down. That's away down to fine leg. Four leg buys. England now 102 runs ahead. That is missed by a fraction of a fraction. Beautifully bowled by Shane Warne. He's only bowled leg breaks today. Bowled this one rather well. That's a good shot. He's got on top of that. He didn't quite come onto the bat. That's why he hit it so far in front of square. Takes England past the 150. Well done, beautifully taken by Ian Healy. Well, he made it look so very easy. Given the chance, as Mark Ramprakash danced down the pitch again, he was looking for that 50, it seems, in dramatic style, but it's not to be. He's stumped beautifully by Ian Healy for just 48.
Oof, flying past the right hand of Mark Taylor at slip.
Well, Peter Martin in the first innings was unafraid to play a few shots.
He caught him. Beautiful catch. I know it went straight at him, but that was beautifully judged. It slapped into the palms. And Peter Martin just wafting a hot bat at it. It's caught and bowled by Kastrovic for three. And a great cheer is for the hero of yesterday, Philip Tufnell. Just a little tester for short square leg. Make sure he's on his toes.
Well, he has been throughout this series. I think a lot of people could have told Phil Tufnell that.
Beautiful catch, flying catch by Healy. A flick of the bat, and the catch going perhaps to Mark Taylor too, but Healy was quickly across there, and the ball banged into the gloves. Caught Healy, Will Kasperwitz, naught a sixth wicket for Kasperwitz, and England 163 for now. Kevin Malcolm, again, cheers around the ground. Not for the batting prowess, but here comes the character, I suppose. There it is, seven for Kasperwitz. A horrible blast of stumps. The sound of timber rattling, and it's all over for England. 163 all out. And that's a good day's work done by Australia yet again.
Yes, a good day's work by the Australians, but can they keep it up now and attack the target they need? 163 there for England. That partnership there between Thorpe and Ramprakash, it could be a match winner. or it could just be a little bit of a face saver. 62 and 48 for them. I thought they both played very well. Bowling figures for the Australians. Kasprowicz, a very unlucky bowler. He might not have had all that much luck in the first innings, but he came good today. 7 for 36 in 15.5 and 5 maidens. Shane Warne, a brave effort from him. He's got a very bad tear of the muscle in his thigh down the right side. Still bowled 26 overs, 9 maidens, 2 for 57. And a wicket for Mark Waugh. That was yesterday. And the situation as the Australians attack their target is that they need 124 to win. 180 for England and 163. The Australians 220 all out. Well, we're going to join in the first over. The fourth ball is about to be bowled. Devon Malcolm is the bowler. Taking strike is Matthew Elliott. 5 runs on the board.
Oh, that must be close.
And it is set out. Well, that was the ball that swung back in.
So Devon Malcolm removes Matthew Elliott. And the score is 5-1.
Well, we can't possibly hope for 1981 again, can we? But this is a good start. Matthew Elliott leaving a delivery that's very straight. Oh, he's belted that through. Really was struck well. Mark Ramprakash at cover. Straight and pretty well timed. Well timed enough just to cruise over that straight boundary down towards the pavilion.
Quite come off the full face through the covers. It squirted a little bit, but seemed to get his feet a bit more towards the pitch of the ball.
That's a good shot. That's beautifully played. Perfect example of how just to get the weight on the back foot, get the weight still in the shot, and place the ball away through the offside.
Is the correct move. Andy Carrick, a bit of extra zip and pace. Oh, got to be close. Galway W, Taylor. Carrick has done it. The change of bowling has worked. And Mark Taylor, the Australian captain, has gone. Galway W now 36 for 2. Mark Waugh, the new batsman. Nicely placed.
Catch! Yeah!
And another one down. Tufnell has done it again. Mark Waugh in similar fashion to the first innings. Gone off the glove. It's an absolute beauty from Tufnell. It has spun and bounced and found the glove. Now Steve Waugh is the new batsman. Well, fewer than 100 to make, but only 7 wickets in hand now. A real game going here. Well fielded. The fielding's been brilliant. And that's in the air. It's not a good ball, but it did go in the air, but well over Michael Atherton's head.
Once again, that inconsistency creeps in with Carrick. Bowls some very good deliveries. That was a poor one.
Umpire Barker has given it out.
It was a very good delivery. It moved back quite sharply off the seam. And it looks as though it's just flicked the front pad, just missed off stump. Good effort by Alex Stewart. And I'd say it's off the pad rather than the bat.
And 11 people shouted.
Oh, there it is again. Beautiful line, lovely flight, drawing the batsman into the shot.
Corner slip. Carrick is overjoyed. Steve Waugh goes for six. And would you believe it, a fifth wicket goes down for 54.
Yeah, Carrick really has grown in confidence. His length has been much more persistent. Little bit of movement there off the seam. Good safe catch by Graham Thorpe. Another fine player, intense moments. Ian Healy storms to the crease, always walks out there as if he's truly looking forward to it.
So close.
So many times during the series we've seen Ian Healy come in and to a ball about that wide, he's flashed away a four to third man, and this time it just hops a little bit.
Oh, what again? Wow.
Extra effort, bent the back, got more bounce, and surprised Ian Healy.
Well, he's trying to get out, isn't he?
The arms again. Every ball's a hand grenade now.
Crikey, I don't know how you play this. Watch this turn and bounce. Oh, I fancy England.
Oh, must have bowled him. Oh, went straight through and straight on, and Tufnell cannot believe it. Oh, Alex Stewart, a spinning action, but it goes more or less straight through and shaves off stump. Oh, off the edge, and that races away down to third man and beats Devon Malcolm.
White.
Beautifully fielded. Oh, had he hit. And the other end. Oh, overthrows. Was it worth the shy? It's a real giveaway in the end. England's so eager to get these wickets. Hussain might well have had a direct hit. Now, that probably would not have been out. Well, I know how they feel. And that's typical Healy. Four runs, and England must hope that he might top edge one of those playing across the spin. Oh, that must be close. That must be very close.
I wonder if he hit it, Tony. No? Oh, dear.
Leg by.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough.
Fine shot, and that's four runs. Nothing routine about that. Attempted bouncer. Cracking shot. So Australia now into the 70s. 73 for five. Target 124. That's a good shot. Beautiful footwork and lovely clip of the bat. And the run's beginning to come for Australia now. And those are byes. Andy Caddick has to do the chasing.
But three more runs for Australia, and they now hit 80, 80 for five. So this is a very important stand in the context of the 124 to win the match. Oh, poor fielding. And that's four runs. So Australia racing away with it now.
Wow. He's LBW. Well, that came as a surprise to Ricky Ponting, not to the crowd here. Ball hits, spins enough to beat the outside edge of the bat, hits the outside of the back pad, which is round about the batting crease, and Phil Tufnell celebrates. Sean Young, the new batsman, coming out. He's on a pair, and he's still in his debut test match. That's a lovely square drive. Atherton may have to put a man out there. We're into the 90s now for the batting side. 92 for six. 32 to go. Got it! Caught it! Caught and bowled. Healy has driven. Didn't quite get it off the middle of the bat. Caddick has got a hand to it. It's bobbled around, and he had his back to us. I suspect that he probably had two or three goes at grabbing it. And England are right on top here. Shane Warne and Greg Blewett are on their way out now. Greg Blewett to run for Shane Warne. Good Yorker. They're further than that, brilliant Yorker. Warne starting off down the pitch. He's done some more damage to his leg. He's also done a little bit of damage to Andrew Caddick's average. Now that should be out. Peter Martin's under it. He's got a good pair of hands, and he'll judge it nicely and gets it. Now Warne has gone. That was a good catch. Nerves of steel, Peter Martin. England on the verge of a win, and a steepling catch like that, your legs can easily go to jelly, and what's more, your hands as well. Looking for two, and we'll get it. Phil Tufnell, the fieldsman.
In the air, a dolly catch. Kasperich goes. Caddick's delighted. The crowd erupt. It's 99 for nine.
It's pitched in short, and Kasperich was too early on the shot. And there was Adam Holyoake, positioned specifically for that type of shot. Graham McGrath's great wish is to score the winning runs in a test match for Australia. He has 25 of them to get if he's going to achieve that in this match.
One more run, and the 100 comes up. Great shot, bit slow on the dive, four runs, fine shot, and happy news that for Sean Young, who gets off the mark for the first time in a test match. At that point, he was on a pair.
Catch!
It's in the air. It's caught. It's all over. England win the test match. Great joy for Michael Atherton. There is a life afterwards for England. 3-2 the series. Ashes gone, but a little bit of respect and self-confidence perhaps comes late.
Yes, a great deal of elation. Justified too. I haven't seen as big a crowd as that at the Oval since way back in 1953 when England won the Ashes after such a long time. Here it wasn't the Ashes, but it was a big win, and the Australians bowled out for 104. Top score there, Ricky Ponting 20, 18 for Mark Taylor and 19 for Blewett and 14 for Ian Healy, but they weren't good enough. That was the thing, and the bowling figures tell the tale once again. A lot of wickets fell for not many runs in this match, and Andrew Carrick came good with 12 overs, two maidens, 5 for 42, bowling in tandem again with Philip Tufnell, 13.1 overs, six maidens and 4 for 27, a wicket there for Devon Malcolm. Well, that's what happened in the match. England won by 19 runs, one of the closest in the history of Test matches. England 180, 163 in their second innings, the Australians 220 and 104. And the man of the match was Philip Tufnell, the presentation made by Tony Lewis, BBC commentator. And the men of the series, England, Graham Thorpe, and the Australians, Glenn McGrath. Now then, that was the end of the formal festivities. Now David Gower talks with the two captains.
Michael, congratulations. What a fantastic day that was.
Yeah, it was a really good game of cricket, although it only lasted 2.5 days or something. It was a really exciting game today for everybody who came.
When you say it only lasted 2.5 days, we all know that. First day, it looked as though, once again, things were going horribly wrong. What was your feelings at the end of that first day?
Yeah, we got a lot of criticism. It was a below-par score, but the wicket was never, you know, the easiest wicket to bat on. I don't think one batsman in the game, or maybe one batsman in the game, made 50. You know, the ball was going through the top a little bit right from the start. Spinners are always going to come into the game, and I always felt it was going to be a reasonably low-scoring match.
Well, you've played very well to get out of the hole, as it were, and a fantastic performance this afternoon. Even so this morning, I mean, there were times there where you'd looked at the performance of the batsman, and you can point to errors, even in a desperate situation here, which, without those, it could have been a more comfortable victory, even, maybe.
Well, you know, Shane Warne bowling on that pitch, not an easy proposition for anybody, particularly the right-handed batsman. And I think you have to take the odd calculated risk. We talked about our game plan last night. And, you know, there's no point just blocking away and blocking yourself into a bunker. And, you know, you can talk about ramps charging down the pitch to get stumped. But, you know, you've got to take the odd risk because you've got to score runs. That's the name of the game.
Well, having got yourself into that position, it looked a very desperate throw. It didn't look as though there were enough runs to play with. But everything went right for you. Full credit again to Phil Tufnell. Tell us something about his match.
Well, I thought the key performance was in the first innings because that enabled us to stay competitive in the match. You know, I had a hope for 150, 200 to play with second innings. Obviously, we didn't get that, but we applied the pressure well. We didn't bowl too much loose stuff, and the pressure gradually built. We got one or two wickets here and there. It was a great victory.
Now, it's time for the big question again. We posed the question after Nottingham. There's been a lot of talk about your own future as a player, as captain especially. What thoughts have you had since Nottingham and since this afternoon, even in the last few minutes, about the future as a captain?
Well, that's a nice way to end the series. And I said before the game that I'd take some time out at the end of the series, which I was appointed for, to decide what I'm going to do, and that remains my position.
Does that mean that now the series is over, you're going to let the dust settle a bit, think about the future, and maybe communicate something to selectors in due course?
Absolutely.
All right, well, we congratulate you on an immaculate performance here this afternoon, both on the field and off. Thanks very much indeed.
Thank you. Cheers.
Now, Mark, that was an extraordinary way to end the series. It seems that this knack of yours of winning the series and losing the final test continues.
Yeah, disappointing, I suppose, but that's the way it goes. I think we, as Michael pointed out, I think we missed opportunities on day two. I was very happy we bowled England out for 180, but he was dead right. It wasn't the world's best wicket, which we're getting used to playing on these days. But we should have made 300. If we'd have made 300 with the bat, as we normally do, batting first, I think we would have won the game comfortably. Chasing 120 was still a very, very gettable total. We chanced our arm and didn't get away with it, so I'm not too disappointed, but it would have been nice to finish off on a winning note.
Nonetheless, of course, whatever the result in this game, you've came and done exactly what you wanted to do. You've taken the Ashes back, figuratively. You've held a replica in your hands. The job is done.
Exactly right, and that's why I'm not too disappointed. As I said, it would have been nice to finish 4-1, to win here. You never like losing, but as I've often said in this situation, I think this is about the fourth time I've had this, we're not good at winning dead rubbers. You look at your players like Stephen Waugh, Ian Healy, they don't seem to play quite as well in these games as they do the game before when the chips are really down. But I don't think that's a fault. I think that's the way it is in modern cricket.
And that's not going to mute the celebrations, is it?
Not at all. As you said, we came over here to win the Ashes. We did that. I think we did it in style. We played the better in four test matches. We're 50-50 here and we're outplayed in the first, so I'm pretty happy.
Does it bother you at all that the real Ashes are going to stay in the museum at Lord's, property of the MCC?
Not really, no. I've never been a big call for them to come home. We come over here to try and win the Ashes, and to me it's a figure of speech more than a need to take them home. I think every guy in the Australian side I've played with sees the Ashes as a big trophy. Yeah. Carrying them around doesn't necessarily make it any bigger. We play because we like playing against England.
It doesn't diminish the satisfaction of doing the job well.
Not at all. I suppose, you know, it'd be the icing on the cake, I suppose, to actually carry them home, but it's not all that big anyway, so it's not as if you can wave it around too much.
Yeah, but it's small, but it means a lot.
Yeah, it does, exactly right, and it's the meaning more so than the actual size or the trophy. It's the history that goes with it.
Well, that's nice to see. They're both happy, and for quite different reasons. Geoffrey Boycott and Ian Chappell now have had their ideas about the match on each of the first two evenings. It's only gone 3 days. Here they are again.
We had a fabulous, enthralling day's cricket. Could have gone either way, the test match, but England scrapped and fought and pressured Australia and for once came out on top. They deserved it. Thorpe was the hero in the morning, batted beautifully. Carrick bowled with some aggression, hitting the deck, getting stuck into the Australians. And Philip Tuffler, well, he had subtlety and spin and he tantalised the Australians. And finally, England got it right. The crowd were marvellous to him, Ian. They really uplifted him, got behind him, and although he lost the Ashes, well, it was a smashing day for England supporters.
Yes, it was, and they were right behind the England side for the whole way. So it's been a good series. There's been a lot of good cricket played. Australia, I think, the better side. 3-2 is probably a reasonable difference between the two teams, but we have seen some excellent cricket. England's best cricket is very good. Unfortunately, it's a bit inconsistent.
Disappointment losing the Ashes, but overall, let's enjoy the day because it was a bit special. We don't get too many England wins, and it was a real good one.
Well, Ian Chappell and Geoffrey Boycott with some down-to-earth observations there on this sixth Test match series, the last one concluding here today. Now, that's the end of the Test cricket for this summer, but the next cricket we'll have for you is the NatWest final. That's at Lord's on September 6, Essex against Warwickshire. That should be a great match. Live coverage will be on BBC television. Now, at the start of the programme, we talked about the Ashes urn and the request from Australia that the original should be sent back with Mark Taylor's side. Well, Mark Taylor is a very happy man. He's retained the Ashes and he's won the series. They've given him a replica and he says, in fact, that he's quite happy with that. He has had a very good series and so too today here at the Oval. Michael Atherton did extremely well. For the moment, from this great ground, it's goodbye.